Welcome to this very special day, a Mother's Day Sunday, right? And yesterday we were able to go out. We were able to maybe get our nails done. I don't know if you took advantage of that now that our governor gave us access to all of these things. But today in our homes, we get to celebrate this special Mother's Day with a message that I know is from God's heart to each and every one of us as a family. This is not just a girl's message, okay? This is a message for all of us as a family. And the title of this message is called Stand Firm. So tell that person next to you, if it's your husband, if it's your kids, just look at them right in the eye and say, stand firm. Just the other day, I jumped for joy when I heard my ring let me know that my package had arrived. Yes. Now, it wasn't just any ordinary package. Although thank you for you know, shout out to all the Amazon drivers for all your deliveries on a daily basis that you're bringing so many things to us that we love to order and necessities. But it wasn't an Amazon package either. So why was I so joyful? Because it was my couch from Costco. Yes, you heard me right. My couch had arrived from Costco. You know you are on the older side of the spectrum when you get that excited from a Costco delivery, right? Now, if you would have seen my old couch, you would understand my excitement. My old couch, for example, had broken drink holders, had broken armrests, had broken thingamajigs to pull up the, you know, your leg rests. It had, everything was wrong with it. Eaten edges. It wasn't me, and it wasn't my daughter's. It was my year-and-a-half-old Rottweiler, Frida, okay? And you would understand my excitement when I heard that my couch had arrived. Now, with all of its broken parts and pieces, this couch had been around for a really long time. Say with me, a really long time. Yes, it had been around for many, many years. And while I was cleaning out, I found these two little things I have in my hands. And what are these little books? They're coupon books made, one by Nicole and one made for me by Isabella. On Mother's Day, many, many, many years ago. For example, Nicole promises me 100 kisses. She also promises me no fighting for 24 hours, and then she writes me and Isabella. So I think I'm gonna cash these in, right? Isabella promises me that she would give me, let me see, she would make dinner, lunch, and breakfast, and clean her room and any other room. That sounds good. But my favorite is this spa day and rub lotion on my feet. I'm gonna, you know, I don't care if they wrote this a long time ago. I'm still holding this coupon book, and I'm trading it in on this Mother's Day. Now, you really know you're on the other side, on the older side of the spectrum, when things like this make you cry. When I found this in my couch, I started crying. I was like, just imagining my little ones when they were little, taking the time to put this together, to staple, to put little hearts on it, and then to write in there all of those things. I think that it's really priceless, just knowing that they took the time for me and they thought about me as they wrote. So yes, I'm one of those moms, guilty as charged. Yes, daughters, I talk to you. I'm one of those moms that really do prefer your time over a gift card, your conversation over the most beautiful of flowers, and your hugs over any pajama set. But enough about me. Today we celebrate all of you moms. Yes, we do. All of the moms, moms of traditional families, moms in special circumstances, single moms, stepmoms, step-in moms, and all those strong and courageous women that have said yes. Yes to teaching and loving someone else at any cost and all costs. For most of us today, Mother's Day is a day of celebration. For me, it's a day of celebration. I still have my mom with me. I get to celebrate her, and I send her from Dolce. I send her this mom brownie and flowers and everything. But for others, Mother's Day is a day of regret. And sadly, for many, a day of mourning. As each of us remember the mom that brought us into this world, can I just say to you that no matter with which of these categories you identify with, God knows, He understands, and He has promised to use all of it for your good. That is His promise, and it is in the Word of God. A mother who has 12 children was asked which one of these little gremlins she loved the most. Her answer was, the one who is sick until he gets well, and the one who is away until he comes back home. Isn't that just the way that we are, girls, right? Like the father of the prodigal son, no matter what we are doing, we are always waiting for them to come back home. 1 Corinthians 13:4-7 says, love is patient and kind. Love is not jealous or boastful. It does not demand its own way. It is not irritable, and it keeps no record of being wronged. It does not rejoice about injustices, but rejoices whenever the truth wins out. Love never gives up, never loses faith. It's always hopeful and endures through every circumstance. Say with me, every circumstance. Look around your house in this moment, in these past couple of months. Look around everything that you've done and everything that we've been through, and say with me, every circumstance. This passage about love is so often used at weddings, at these beautiful wedding ceremonies. But as a mom, one cannot deny that is all too precise and true for the love that we feel for our children. A love that never gives up but endures through every single circumstance. A mother wrote this: how is it that a human being can love a child so deeply that you willingly give up a major portion of your freedom for it? How can a mortal love be so strong that you voluntarily subject yourself to responsibility, vulnerability, anxiety, and heartache, and just keep coming back for more of the same? What kind of mortal love can make you feel, once you have a child, that your life is never, ever yours again? Maternal love has to be divine, right? It has to be divine. There's no other explanation for it. Although I might not always be the perfect parent, I know both my daughters would agree that my love for them is perfect. A perfect love. Not in a way that I am without error or that I'm always right, although us moms can say most of the time we are, but rather in a way that my love for them is complete. It is full circle. You don't know where it begins and where it ends. And not only is it perfect, but it's powerful. Say with me, powerful. Isaiah, so powerful that Isaiah actually compared it to God's love for each of us. In Isaiah 66:13, he says this: as one whom his mother comforts, so I will comfort you. How beautiful is that? I believe that there is no greater compliment able to be given to a mother than it's used to compare God's love with the love that we have for our own children. A mother, a woman with a mother's heart, is one who comforts. Yes, it's one who comforts. In this coronavirus, stay home, new normal, crazy, abnormal life, yes, because it is abnormal, there are mothers everywhere that have had to stand firm and comfort their families. Try and bring stability, love, direction, and a whole lot of therapy as well. Between the schoolwork, the homework, the housework, the cooking, the remodeling, because you know we all did some DIY, reinventing and budgeting, we stand firm so our family can feel comforted. We have to stand firm. firm. We see this so perfectly modeled by Jesus's mother, Mary. Last year in my Mother's Day message, I actually spoke about Mary, but I spoke about when she became pregnant. But this year, I want to speak about Mary's life and how she teaches us to stand firm. So John 19, 17 to 27 says this, carrying the cross by himself, he went to the place called the place of the skull, in Hebrew, Golgotha. There they nailed him to the cross. Two others were crucified with him, one on either side, with Jesus between them. And Pilate posted a sign on the cross that read, Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. The place where Jesus was crucified was near the city. And the sign was written in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek, so that many people could read it. Then the leading priests objected and said to Pilate, change it from the King of the Jews to he said, I am the King of the Jews. Pilate replied, no, what I have written, I have written. When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they divided his clothes among the four of them. They also took his robes, but it was seamless, woven in one piece from top to bottom. So they said, rather than tearing it apart, let's throw dice for it. This fulfilled the scripture that says, they divided my garments among themselves and threw dice for my clothing. So that is what they did. Standing near the cross were Jesus' mother and his mother's sister Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother standing, say with me, his mother standing. He saw his mother standing at the foot of the cross. No, she wasn't, you know, she wasn't crying out and throwing herself on the floor. No, his mother was standing at the foot of that cross. There's something powerful about that. And I believe that the Bible makes mention because this is so what we as mothers need to do. In all situations and in all circumstances, we need to stand. And it says, his mother standing there beside the disciple he loved, he said to her, dear woman, here is your son. Obviously, John writing this. And he said to the disciple, here is your mother. And from then on, this disciple took her into his home. In the end, although all of his disciples were scattered because of fear, except for John. It was basically every man for himself as they hid from the Roman government and they hid from the Jewish leaders that considered Jesus a heretic. But Jesus was not alone. Yes, he hung on that cross, and standing at the foot of his cross, at that cross, was his mother at the foot of his cross. There were all these women who loved him. And it's notable that the women were there. All the women that followed Jesus made themselves present. But his mother notably stood at the foot of his cross. She stood there as not only a witness to the truth of his ministry, saying, yep, I'm here. I'm here as a witness that I'm still standing here for my son. But actually, she stood saying to everyone that she loved him despite the fact that others hated him. That she believed in him even when others didn't believe. When you stand, when you put yourself out there and you look upon even the most tragic of situations, but you make known that you are present for that person. And that's what us mothers need to do. In every situation, in every storm, we need to stand at the foot of the cross. She loved him despite the fact that he was found guilty. She loved him and stood there despite the fact that others mocked him and threw dice for his clothes. She loved him and stood at the foot of the cross despite her own risk of being singled out and killed. In William Barclay's commentary on this text, he discusses Jesus' mother Mary's presence at the cross, saying that maybe she could not understand, but she could love. Her presence there was the most natural thing in the world for a mother. Jesus might be a criminal in the eyes of the law, but he was her son. So she risked everything, saw everything, witnessed everything, but she remained when others left. The prophet Simeon at the temple is a just and devout man of Jerusalem. And this prophet met Mary and Joseph and Jesus when he was just a baby. He was just 40 days old, and this prophet met them at the temple as they were going to dedicate their firstborn son to God. On taking Jesus into his arms when he was only 40 days old, he uttered a prayer. He gave a prophecy alluding to the crucifixion. And it's not going to come up on your screen, but I want to read it to you. Luke 2, 29 to 32 says this, "Sovereign Lord, now let your servant die in peace. As you have promised, I have seen your salvation," as he had the baby in his arms, "which you have prepared for all people. He is a light to reveal God to the nations, and he is the glory of your people to Israel." Well, that was nice, wasn't it? Wasn't that a beautiful promise? But it didn't end there. He continued. And verse 34 says this, "Then Simeon blessed them." So he looks at Joseph and Mary and he blesses them. But then something happens. He turns directly to Mary. The Bible says it. It says he blesses them. He blessed the family. But then it says that he turns directly to Mary and he said to Mary, the baby's mother. He looked at her. And this is for you, Mom. This is for you. This is the prophet speaking to you today. Maybe you have felt weak. Maybe you have felt like no one is watching. Maybe you have felt forgotten. But right now, today, the prophet goes and looks at you. So he turns to Mary and he says this, "This child is destined to cause many in Israel to fall and many others to rise. He has been sent as a sign from God, but many will oppose him. As a result, the deepest thoughts of many hearts will be revealed." And I imagine that Mary, if I was Mary, and remember, Mary had already been visited by an angel. So now the prophet's speaking to her, and she knows what she has in her arms. She has big hopes. I mean, she knows that he is the savior of this world. And she's holding him. And she's like, okay, I got this. I mean, the angel's already told me. Like, this is good. I understand. But he continued. He didn't stop there. And the prophet Simeon said these words, "And a sword will pierce your very soul." And a sword will pierce your very soul. This was spoken to Mary. Now, suffering is not something that attracts the masses. It doesn't. But it does call in those that love you perfectly, that love you wholeheartedly. So there she stood at the foot of the cross as a sword pierced her very soul, but she stood firm. I think we can all agree with what 1 John 4:18 says, that such love has no fear. She did not run like the other disciples. I'm sorry, she didn't. And I'm not criticizing them, but they ran because they were full of fear. But 1 John says that such love has no fear because perfect love, complete love, full circle love expels all fear. And I could just imagine Mary standing at the foot of that cross, watching her son, feeling the sword pierce her heart, but there she stood. A mother's love, perfect and powerful. A love that stands firm when everyone else runs the other way. This love, this one that brings God worship. Did you know that your love brings God worship? My 40-something self has just begun to understand all my mother has done for me, and if truth be told, I have found it difficult to replicate. Just now, when I'm living out her life and I'm watching my girls grow and I'm getting into these new things that I thought the hard stuff was behind me. No, the hard stuff is just ahead. And as I try to replicate how beautifully my mother lived out her life, it really is hard. When we are five, we think, wow, mom knows everything, right? But then when we're about 10, we think, mom doesn't really know all things, does she? When we're about 15, we're like, mom knows nothing. Then we're about 20-something, we say, well, mom might know some things. When we're 30-something, we say, let's see if my mom knows. When we are 40-something, we say, I'm sure my mom knows this. Romans 12:1 says this, and so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you. This is a pleading. I plead with you. And it says, what is he pleading with us? That you to give your bodies to God because of all he has done for you. Let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind he will find acceptable. This is truly the way to worship him. Wow. What? Could there be a better verse for motherhood? This sacrifice is constant and consistent. It continues long after our babies become toddlers, who then become children, who then become teenagers, who then become parents, who then become themselves grandparents. From sleepless nights spent breastfeeding, yes, we all did it, and long working days, months and years, we mothers know what it is to present our bodies as sacrifices. But I wonder, do we really understand? Do we really understand what we stand firm for? Do we really comprehend just how important our work is? How beautiful and acceptable it is to God? I don't think we do. The verse says, let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind he will find acceptable. This is truly the way to worship him. So I just want to remind you on this Mother's Day, that God sees you. Yes, he does. He sees you at 2 a.m. when you're breastfeeding, or at 4 a.m. when you're changing that diaper. He sees everything everyone else doesn't see or doesn't value. If you have felt undervalued, if you have felt invisible, or like if you're just doing things without being, like you're being overlooked, let me just tell you that God spoke to me and he told me, look into that camera and let those girls know, let those mamas know that I see you, that he sees you, and that what you're doing is worship. And it's more beautiful than any song anyone can write. Or it's more beautiful than any you know, keys or anything you could put together. It is just more beautiful because it is really worship. He sees you. He sees your day in and your day out. He is there with you. He knows and understands. And I want you to know that everything we do, girls, is worship. Although you might not see it now, I want you to know, or rather he wants you to know, the God wants you to know, your father wants you to know, that you are doing, what you are doing is life-giving. Yep. It's kingdom advancing. It's eternity changing. It's soul enriching work, and it is holy and it's acceptable in the eyes of God. And this is our worship. When you live out your life, when you feed your babies, when you nurture them, when you hug them, when you cry, when you plead with God for that son to come home, when you ask Lord to, and you intercede, when you are worried for them as curfews right around the corner, as you plead with dad and try to explain to him the whys they did what they did, as you do everything that a mom does, it's worship. Because just as Mary, that beautiful, beautiful example to us, just remember that she stood there. For as ugly as it got, she stood there for her son and she worshiped. And it's holy and it's acceptable. So let us stand. Yes, let us stand. Let us stand at the foot of the cross as living testimonies that we serve a good God, that we serve a faithful God, that we serve a God that pours into us the love that we are able to give each and every one of our children according to what they need, because it truly is divine. Wow. I just love this word because I really felt that God gave me this word for myself as well. And I know that we've gone through, you know, just a couple of crazy months being moms, being trying to be friends, trying to be, you know, our husband's wife, cook, everything. And I don't say it lightly when I say therapist, because some of our homes are crazy, or most of our homes. We just all need help. Pray for yourself, right? I pray for myself. But through it all, I think what I want to be known for is that no matter how dark the night gets, or how weak I feel, or how vulnerable I feel, that I would be remembered as a woman who stood. And I want you to stand next to me too, for us to be that generation that stands firm as an example to our daughters so that they can also stand firm. Let's pray. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Father, because your word is good, because your word is timely, because your word is life-giving and it's transformational. It goes so beyond information. It is transformational. Thank you. Thank you for seeing. Thank you for speaking to our hearts. And I ask that any resentment or any hurt or any burden that has been laid upon any one of us would just be healed completely, would just be lifted off in Jesus' name. I ask for miracles to be performed in every home. And if there's tears in the eyes of these women as they hear this message, as there's tears in my eyes, I ask you, Lord, that you would receive them as part of our worship. In Jesus' name, amen. Happy Mother's Day.